Welcome to Starkey Outdoors. We are going to do an epic shad tank build like no other. All right, here's my shad tank. It has got a drain that is a 3/4 inch pipe drain. This is a 500 gallon tank, and it is it's 2 feet tall. Here's the drain from the inside, right there. So, better have a way to get them to your place. It takes a big trailer. I think it's 8 feet around. Here is the info on this one. It's a Freeland poly tank. And the numbers tore off. Sorry guys, I got it at one of our tractor supply, or not tractor supply, it's called Orchids or something like that, Orchlands, I don't know. Yeah, a farm supply store. But being round, that should keep my shad, you know, from banging their noses and stuff. Plenty of water, 500 gallons. Okay. This is my water pump. We'll get into that later. It's got the digital controller. This is the actual pump itself. We'll see. This is my digital thermostat. It's like it's on and off. I'll put a link in the description to all of these, but let me get this out here. Do this with one hand. Yeah, it looks pretty nice actually. This is going to control the heater right there, the heating. And this is going to control the cooling right there. And I'll be able to set the temperatures and parameters and all that. We'll go through that. This is a light, aquarium light. It's got 3 different colors. It's, well, 4. It's, well, all those. All these colors right here. It's just for coolness. Just to look cool. That's all. So back to the pump, we have, this is our pump controller. This pump is adjustable. It's got like 4 different settings. It's made out of, feels like it's made out of plastic. This is the one I got, or I'm going to use. It's 24 volt, 40 watts, I don't know, 1,350 gallons per hour. It's made by that company right there. You got it off Amazon. So it's got a, this is your intake. I'm going to go ahead and set this inside my tank. I'm going to use this one here. I'll put this one on. It'll go on like that. I think that'll be better for the shad not getting, you know, sucked up into the, you know, stuck on this, because every now and then it happens on my bait tank. So you got a choice. You can use this style right there for your outlet, or you can use probably this one right here and put and glue a hard pipe into that. And this is what I'm going to use right here. You know, of course, it's got O-rings and all that stuff. It's got a, you know, you put that on there and you screw this on, and then your pipe goes in there. We shall see. It's about $90 off Amazon for this pump. They don't last forever. Yeah, anyway, it's kind of cool being able to control the volume, because you can regulate it with ball valves, you know, partially open. But with this, I can bump it up, or, you know, I didn't want to do an overkill. I'm just not sure where we're going to be at yet. So this gives me options. This is my full immersion heater. It's pretty powerful. This is to keep the shad from getting too cold on the really cold days in the winter time. This is going to float around in my ice chest. It's going to hang in there. And the digital controller over here, this will turn it on and off. And last but not least, I've got a UV green killer. I'm not leaving these shad in here for a long time. I'm using them pretty quick. So, you know, I'm not worried about them having all the biological stuff right. I don't want algae growing and everything turning green on me. So we'll see. We'll see if this works. I'll put a link in the description for this one too. Everything here come from Amazon. One box. So here is my little setup to keep the shad cool in the summertime. And I don't know how cold they're going to get or how much this is going to do. This is a 7 cubic feet freezer, chest freezer. So my plan is to bring water into this and have it run out, basically. And you'll see my setup here in a little while. But while we're on this, so I took and sealed every little seam, like these seams right here. I sealed the whole bottom area. I sealed the drain plug in there, and I used Goop Marine right there. The reason is it's going to have a UV light in here, and I want it protected from deterioration. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spray all this in here with Flex Seal. So that serves two purposes. For one, it goes over my seams again. For two, if I end up using rock salt in my shad tank, this aluminum, it might be another barrier for protection. So basically, this thing's going to fill up. There'll be a hole right up here, and this thing's going to fill up like this, and it's going to go out these two drain holes and run out gravity fed into my tank, and probably through a filter on this side too. We'll see. I'll show you what I'm talking about. And that's it right there. 7 cubic feet. This is a scratch and dent model. I paid $150 for it. I don't know what the brand is. There's something here. If this works and you guys want to do one of these, let me give you some advice. Let me show you something here. There's a learning curve. This is what not to do. You know, you don't get mad and do like I did. But so originally it was going to be in the front, and I was going to drill two holes right through here. And well, anyway, it's got return lines right here. And the first thing I did is I drilled right through these return lines. This is your, I believe, your Freon lines are here. They're a little bit lower. And so I popped a hole, and I was going to cut it out and tear it back and dig for the Freon lines, but they're right up against the edge, and I hit it with my hole saw right off the bat. So this was my guinea pig. Lost me $150 real quick. But what I found out, I got to doing some investigating, and there are no return lines in the back. So this left, this area right in here, you have two Freon lines, and this area down a little ways is open. So this is where you want to punch your holes on this particular model. The back doesn't have return lines. Your hinges go here and here, but it's just like a little plate. It'll have Freon lines on the inside. Well, this is the Freon line right here. But anyway, yeah, I threw a little old fit. I got mad. This is what your hinge is. They just got these plates that's in the epoxy, or in that foam, epoxied into that foam. But yeah, anyway, got it out of my system. Don't do like I did. Now you know, if you use this particular model, go through the back if you want to punch drain holes. So just FYI, this is about the best stuff money can buy as far as waterproof sealant. It's a 3M 5200. This one's white. It needs to be a little bit warmer to dry. I put some out on one of my buckets and it's still wet in this cool temperature where the goop is dried pretty hard. It's been about 20 hours. So this stuff takes a little longer to dry, but it is great when it dries. You're never going to have a problem with this stuff. It's just real hard to find. You're not going to go to Ace Hardware. Lowe's had some in tubes, big tubes, but you're best off order it from Amazon or somewhere. Get it, or maybe Bass Pro Shop, and make sure you got plenty of this on hand way ahead of time before you start your project. Marine sealant, 5200, 3M. So here's my plans for my gravity drain pipe. I have these 2 inch by 1 1/4, I don't know what they're called, couplings. They're gonna go on here like that. And then I'm gonna shove this all the way back and they'll sit flush, both of them together. And it doesn't interfere with being able to close the door. The door still closes just fine. But this is gonna get, all this is gonna get filled up really good with marine adhesive. And they're going to come out in the back. They're going to look like this. They'll be out here and they'll gravity feed back into my tank. I've got a 90 also. I'm going to probably put these 90s on them so it'll look cool, maybe like that. And I'm going to hang right here, I'm going to hang 200 micron filter socks off each one of these just for an added filter. Really, there's no reason not to, but I'm leaving them kind of long right now until I see where I want them once I get this all in position. So that's what we're going to do next. We are going to put these on and seal them up. It's a 1 1/4 pipe. It's actually not schedule 40, it's a thinner wall, that way I get a bigger opening, seems like. I don't know, not that big a deal. To seal this hole right here, I'm going to be using this flex glue. I'm going to give it a try. It says it's waterproof and everything. The flex products actually are pretty good. So made in the USA, look at there, buddy. So we're going to be using that to seal these holes off. All right, we are ready for our first spray job of flex seal. So shake it up real good. It's I'm filming this in January in Oklahoma, so it's about 45-50 degrees outside, so everything's going to take a little bit longer to cure. I'd like to get 2 coats on here. I try not to get ahead of myself, but anyway, here we go. I've got these done now. I'm going to try to avoid spraying those and give that stuff a little bit more time to air cure. I want to hit these seams in here where the little motor is and stuff like that. I'm gonna try to concentrate on that. So this is the clear. I don't think you can overdo it. Hit these seams first. Spray it all in there. And anyway, I'm gonna go ahead and spray the whole thing, and that way it should protect it against the rock salt if I decide to use some. Stay tuned. So now I'm going to go with my bucket filter. This is going to set up on top of the freezer, and it'll all gravity feed after it goes in through the bucket filter. And I just went off what I found on YouTube. They're not that hard. Everybody's got their different designs and stuff, but let me show you what I'm going to do here. So I've got a clear bucket. That made a lot of sense. That way you can kind of see when water's moving and stuff like that. It's a painter's bucket. And then I put a 1.5-inch coupling on this side with that 5200 sealant. And it's screwed together. So once that sealant dries, it'll be pretty solid. Inside the bucket, I'm going to go with this system here. It'll sit down in the bottom, and it'll spin the water in different directions. And it'll gravity feed up through the filters and then come out the hole, and it'll run down into this freezer tank. And this will sit in here like this. And this is just a little strainer I found at the dollar store for a couple bucks. And, you know, this will go down in here. My water will come down in there and filter up. Now, I'll show you what kind of media. I'm going to use scrubbies and some air conditioner filter and maybe scouring pads. And then after that, of course, it'll drain through the 200 micron socks. So you got to be careful on shad. Hang on here. You got to be careful on shad because they produce a lot of scales and slime. And if you're going to filter this water too much, you're going to plug stuff up pretty quick. I'm not trying to keep them alive for a month. I'm trying to keep them alive for a couple weeks because I'm a fishing guide, and I go through them a lot. And I want to be able to have ready access to my shad without having to go to the lake the day before. On the lakes that doesn't have shad, there's a couple lakes I fish that they don't have a good supply of shad. Plus, it's just convenient. You know, you can get up in the morning, man, you don't have to go for bait or nothing. You can just hit that prime time. So that's kind of my theory on this. Here we go. So on my bucket lid, I'm going to drill this center part out to a 2-inch. And the reason is on that stem coming out of my bucket, I'm going to have a coupling goes right through here. I need to be able to pull this, you know, this lid through there. This will be on the other end, and that way I can just, you know, unscrew this, take this off, and I will be able to pull this up and get in there and change my filters. I can't just work on it on top of the freezer, so I need to be able to disconnect it. I'm using flexible line going to it, so I can just set it on the ground or do whatever with it and carry it outside or whatever and clean my bucket, my filters. 2-inch hole, here we go. So there's my 2-inch hole. Like you say, see, this will pull right up through it like that. So I can take the lid off, even with that bigger coupling on there. All right. So my hose here, I got it at Lowe's. It's a corrugated tubing. And I went ahead and I got this 1-inch ID. And it was like 20 bucks for this. And this is what's going to come out of the pump and go into the bucket. So to attach this to my bucket, I'm going to switch it over and I'm going to show you. I'm going to use this 3/4-inch threaded stuff, this fitting. So I might put a little sealant in there, but this thing, this screws in here perfectly. I mean, once you thread it on there, you can't hardly pull it out. I mean, you can't. So with a little bit of sealant and a hose clamp, so once I get that switched over on this end, this will go like this, like that, and right into my bucket. So that's ready. It's all glued in there. It's a very tight fit. That's all ready to be attached to the female side of the coupling. And with just a short piece of 3/4-inch PVC. So I'm going to glue this side on, this coupling. Right like that. Now, I can still pull this up and out. to gain access to all my filters. All right. So I brought my stock tank inside and I'm starting to fit everything up now, making sure that all the hoses are going to be in the right position. I'm wanting to keep my pump placed right here, centrally located, but I've only got a 6-foot cord and I want to come straight up from this pump, straight up, and put about right here, even with this, put a T. And this side will be my spray bar and my connection for my garden hose. This side will go over here, or maybe I'll put it on an angle that way. Yeah. So this side will go over there, and that will be where the black hose hooks up. I'll run rigid line from there to there across at a 90, like this is, straight across, and that way it'll support the weight. It won't put any undue pressure wobbling around on this thing. But my problem is, I don't know if I can come up enough. It'll be close. Come up that far and still go over here. Yeah, I think I'll have enough and be able to mount my control box with a Velcro or something. I think I'll have enough. So that's kind of what we're at. So right now I'm going to glue this one in here, come off with a 90 right there, and this will be my pipe that goes down into a hole right here. And when it runs through the filter, it'll run out this, it'll run down into the hole, and I'm going to put a stem pipe, and I'll explain that here in a little while. But this thing is threaded, so I can remove my stem pipe and lift the whole bucket off. So the hardest part of this build, without a doubt, is going to be this, making room. Most of this stuff is, well, a lot of it's got some value, but a lot of it don't. Anybody want a free table? Table saw? You name it. You can tell I'm a duck hunter. This side, it's fairly clean, organized. But that's going to be my hardest part, is getting rid of this dadgum thing. I think I'm going to put it kind of in this area. That way, I can go right from here into my bait tank. You know, I'm running a bait tank in this big sea arc like that. In the wintertime, these fish will stay alive for a couple weeks just in that. It's crazy. Summertime, a few hours. So that's where I hope that freezer, you know, helps out. So what I'm going to do now is a pretty critical part. This little thing right here came with the pump, and I've only got one of them. So this should glue in just like this, which it looks like it's going to. So I just don't want to destroy this, because you ain't going to find one. You'll have to order it or something, you know, if I break this. So anyway, here we go. So I got that glued on there. My next step is to figure out where to put my T, you know, to cut it and make it where it's going across flush, so it's supported by the side rails, each one of these T bars, the spray bar and the pump line itself. All right, I temporarily hooked this up. It looks like it's a little bit high from the pump, a little bit of a bow in it. So I'm gonna take a little bit off. So this end will come out, be my spray bar. I'll drill holes in this. And on this end here, I'm gonna have a hose fitting. The other purpose of that one over there is, of course, to pressurize the, or push water to the filter system and everything. And these will all be cut to length. And actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a coupling on each one so I can disconnect them and take them apart if I ever need to gain access or whatever. I don't know. I'm going to do it. Whether I need it or not, different story. So next we're going to put this on. I got these things cut. So this will go, you know, like this. This will go into this threaded portion. Got some old Blue Devil. He's a mean looking dude. And then we're going to glue that onto this. That way I've got water to fill up my my boat tank. So I went ahead and put a gate valve on this end here, and that way I can either turn the pump off, or I can, you know, I can if I need to work on the filter for a long period of time but I want to keep the water swirling, I can do that by just shutting off this gate valve. And I put it upside down, that way it helps it. It can't get pulled across. It just kind of helps. Same way on the other end. The other end, I got my deal to fill up my live well for the garden hose on my boat. So now what I'm going to do is this comes out and goes to my pump. And the hose clamp we just put on, I'm going to glue this onto here. And we're getting close, actually. So next I'm going to pop a hole. I'm going to use this two-inch hole saw, and I am going to drill down into my freezer right here for the downspout. And I'm going to run it long, and that way, well, I'll show you here in a second. All right, we got a nice hole right there. And we're going to put our downspout. So the 2-inch hole is a really nice fit. And we will take a measurement and cut it. So since this is for, hang on here. Since this is for heating and cooling, my theory is as it comes out of the bucket, when it's in the cooling mode, I want this downspout to go all the way down a couple inches from the bottom, because when that hot water goes down there, it's going to want to rise back up. And if it just came out and just went down a little bit and right out these spouts, all my cold water would be settled at the bottom of this. So What my plan is for this to go down, that hot water to go down to the bottom of the freezer when it's in the cooling mode, at least, it'll be an advantage. And then that hot water, or the warmer water, will rise back up, and that'll kind of circulate things inside the freezer during the summertime, rather than just hit that surface and run right back out, because all the cold water would be settled on the bottom. So that's why we're going to use a longer downspout and keep it, you know, a couple inches from the bottom. So that'll give me about that much, maybe a little bit more, from the bottom of the tank. All right. Like I say, this is a screw-on deal, so I can unscrew it and get my bucket off. Nice. We are starting to get there. Getting closer. Awesome. I'm going to spray the inside of this with a Flex Seal just to kind of do some waterproofing there. Not to seal it, you know, I want to be able to take it in and out easily, but I'm just going to kind of waterproof it. So this is the filter I'm going to use. It's bought it at Lowe's. I don't remember how much it was, but I'm going to use two or three, four of these. I've already got my scrubbies down here on top of my little strainer. So, and I might throw a couple of these in on top and spread them around for good measure. All right. So what I did is I got my scrubbies around my, you know, my basket, and I'm going to go in with one of these filters, and I'm gonna go in with another one of these filters, kind of squish it around in here. It's a little bit on the big side. And then I'm gonna lay these in here. I don't see a sense to get any reason to get real fancy. This way I can just throw them away or whatever. Just kind of layer them on top of each other. And just an added filter. Got to be careful because these shad, I'm afraid you can over filter it and everything will just start plugging up on you because they emit so many scales and slime. I'm not interested in keeping them alive for months on end. I just keep them alive for a little while, a couple, 3 weeks. Okay, and then this one here, it'll go down in and it's going to tuck in here, seal all around here. My stuff's still a little wet. Get in there. And then I might put some rocks. They didn't have any lava rocks at the store, but I'm gonna go look at a different store. Maybe put some lava rocks just to keep this from floating up. Water will come in, it comes out, flows down. You know the deal. So that's kind of how I did that. So I've got my downspouts put on. I'm not gonna glue those. I'm gonna see how this works. These filter socks I got they come in today. They're pretty big. I mean, that's really big. And my theory, or my thinking is I'm gonna be able to put these over like this and pull them backwards and like this. If I go too low in this area, I'm going to get into my water and I don't wanna do that. So I'm gonna keep them kind of tight, high and tight. The only other thing I can do is raise my freezer if it becomes an issue with like four cinder blocks. And I might just go ahead and do that. Yeah, I might do that. But if I do that, then I don't think this hose is gonna be long enough. No, I'll have to cut another hose. But that's no biggie. Anyway, that's kind of where we're at now. And I'm going to drill a hole right here, and this hole is going to be for my UV light and my heater to hang down in, and the wires will come back and they'll go to a like a plug-in panel thing there. So that's kind of what I'm going to do next, is drill that hole. So I got my hole drilled, got my heater probe and UV light inside there. I'm going to use this the black Gorilla double-sided tape, and I'm going to put this 15 amp power strip probably right there like that, and then I'll put my controller over there and be able to plug stuff into here. Hopefully 15 amps will work. If not, it'll let me know. Breaker will let me know. Okay, the next thing I'm going to do is drill my spray holes. I've marked off the center line, and I think I'm going to put probably 8. I'm going to start off small and then see how that works. So it's going to take some time to tweak this. Since I have a coupling on the end, I can adjust the angle that they're hitting the water at until I get the right amount of motion. And I've got them spaced 3 inches apart for now. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes. We are going to start filling her up. So I'm running all the water through this. It's a RV filter. Supposed to be pretty good. It is, I don't know, I'll put a link in the descriptions. But there's the service life and stuff like that. It's supposed to do 10,000 gallons. Anyway, this should remove most of the chlorine. And what it doesn't remove, I will put some additive in there. I have a chlorine tester, so we'll see. So this is how I set my filter up. I just put electrical tape around this. I got one of my wife's little hair deals. I went around that and I just hook it there, just like that. That way it keeps it kind of up on an angle. I didn't want it sitting down, you know, down, because it tended to run backwards. So we're going to keep it up a little bit, just like that. It seems to be about the right amount. You can kind of turn it a little bit. But, yeah, you can already see it's... Now, I'll probably increase my pump volume. This is just a garden hose going through that filter, filling things up right now. Pump's starting to get underwater here in a second. We're going to start field trials. We're going to turn that pump on. Well, I got my pump turned down all the way, 30%. Looks like this is going to work out pretty good. Everything's going fairly well. That's going good. That's going good. We're just filling her up. That's hooked up. I got a couple bricks in there. I didn't have any lava rock, but the flow looks pretty good coming out. Only one problem. I got a leak in my freezer. So we are going to drain that back into this with a pump, and I am going to flex seal the heck out of it again. I don't want it to get into the motor, so I'm gonna do that pretty quick. So I got a little drip right here, even though I've flex sealed the inside. It's leaking a little bit, so I got to drain this tank out. So it's kind of nice to have this so I can just turn my pump on and get most of it out. And then I had my leak inside. Turns out that all this black flex seal, it was leaking right in here. This is a deal there where it's really leaking good. So I'll show you what I'm going to use. Did some research. Flex paste. I'm going to try flex paste. We'll see if that'll fix it. It dries underwater, they say, and that 5200, man, it just takes too long to dry. It dries underwater too, but they're saying like 7 days or something. I don't want to wait that long. So we're going to gob this up really good with flex paste and just see. Maybe it'll work. It better. All right, so we're getting closer. I made a couple adjustments. I didn't realize I had this little thermometer. It came with the heating probe. And I'm running the thermometer down into here so I know what this temperature is going to be. And also decided to move my heating probe out here because it doesn't move enough volume. And I was scared that this temperature would get way hot, like 100, 120 degrees, before it had time to circulate and run out and bring this 500 gallons worth of temperature up. So I'm going to let that heating probe stay in here, and this thing will shut it off when this gets hot, not when this gets hot. In the winter or in the summertime with it cooling, I'm not too worried about that. If it gets too cold in here, the heater will kick on and warm it up. It's kind of, I don't foresee that happening in the summertime, but I don't want this getting really hot. Plus, it's a fire hazard, because if this thing would leak and that heating probe was left in there, just dangling like that, it would catch fire. Don't ask me how I know that. So anyway, the heater probe stays out here, and it's where it can't touch anything. It's suspended with tie straps, triple, so it won't melt a hole in the bottom of this. And I know it's in the Shad's way, but in the summertime, you know, I'll take it and I'll set it up here like this and unplug the whole heating system when I don't need it. I just don't want my Shad getting down to, you know, 35, 38 degrees, or, you know, on really cold temperatures. That's where we're at. And we are filling this up for its second set of sea trials. We got our leaks fixed so far, and yeah, and I'm just kind of waiting on my UV light to get here. Should be here today off Amazon. So far, so good. No leaks. Draining out real nice. We got in there anything? Got my heater dangling. Got the pumps are sucking. Water's a spraying. Draining out pretty good here. No major leaks. Going through the filter system. It was leaking down here, but I think I got it fixed. So it's gonna take a few hours to fill this thing up, and then I'll turn the heater on and see how that functions while I'm out here. All right. So I'm not happy during the sea trials. I come back and my Shad are dead. I only had three of them in there, but anyway, I'm pretty sure it's the chlorine in the water. This thing that's supposed to take out all the chlorine, I don't think it did a good job. But since I am a water operator, we're going to check it out, and I'm going to show you how to do a little test here with some of our equipment. So I got this chlorometer. I don't know. Anyway, zeroed out with it being in the dark. This thing here keeps it shaded, so we're zeroed out. This is water before it went through the filter. And this is our total chlorine powder in there. 1.76. Okay. It's not bad. It's a little high. This is water I pulled from my tank. That's not good enough. It'd kill my fish. If I have to, I'm gonna start using lake water. But I've got some chemicals, some liquid I can put in there, and I might try that next to see if that helps. So also during my sea trials, this is the second time I've had a leak. It wasn't quite this bad. But overnight, it leaked some, and I emptied my tank out. I'm getting tired of fixing this tank, and I don't know the longevity if I ever get this small leak stopped. I don't know if it's just expanding it or what. I'll show you, man. I've got sealant in all the right places, it looks like. Yeah. Anyway. So what I'm going to do is, my dead shad from the chlorine, is I'm going to work on this situation, and I'm going to run PEX inside that tank right there, inside that freezer, through my filter and then back in. That way I don't have to fill that freezer up with water. So I'm going to change my design, show you how it's done. It's getting frustrating, but I'm too deep into this to give up now. I'm almost there. So I'm going to use some PEX. We're going to run it through there. With all the coils will be inside, it'll come back out. And hopefully, when this freezer's running, it'll cool it off enough to start dropping this temperature of the water in the summertime. It's either going to do it or it's not, but that's all I can do. So I'm going to try this stuff here. Yeah, we'll see. So if you read the instructions, basically 5 milliliters or 1 capful per every 20 gallons of pond water. So I don't know what they mean by that. I mean, maybe pond water's from your garden hose that filled your pond up. And it says dosage can be doubled for startup treatments or in times of fish stress. And it needs to sit there for 24 hours. So, once we get all this leakage fixed and this thing redone, we're going to try that, and I'll let you know how that works. So I'm going to use 3/4 inch PEX. This stuff right here, I'm going to use 100 feet of it. And I've got a female, a PEX, a shark's bite with a female. And that's going to screw right onto there. This coil is going to go inside my freezer. Then it's going to pop out and it'll be connected to that with another one of these. So this needs to be 1.13 inches is the seating depth. I'll make a mark and almost just all you do is push it on. That's next. Weeks along the way, when those shad die, they end up getting sucked up into the pump with this low water filter. So I thought it'd be kind of cool, but I don't need it. I'm going to go back and I'm going to put this one on. This one, I don't think they'll get stuck on this one as bad. So what I could do is I could go with a timer system where it kicks off like 1 minute out of every 10, and that'll release the shad if they're stuck to it, if they're dead and stuck to it. Or I could put a bag. They sell little nylon mesh bags. So this is going to be an easy fix, but I thought I'd tell you I'm switching out from the low water to just the normal one. Man, I hope this works, because we got about $1,100 in it or better. So far, so good. We'll see. So I decided to do a couple things different before I even got too far along. I'm going to go ahead and put in this Danco Venturi system. I don't know how it's going to work yet, but I figure, what the heck, you know, everybody seems to really have rave reviews about it. So this is the it's the 11, the LV11 is the one I'm using. So it's just an added deal to put oxygen in the water. So we're going to install that. Then I've also got a digital timer. And what I'm doing, this is the brand I bought. What I'm doing is cycling my pump on and off. And that's just an extension cord. I'm going to cycle my pump on and off in case any shad gets stuck on the intake of it. It'll turn off for 20 seconds. Once every 30 minutes, it turns off for 20 seconds. So that's where we're at. I'm putting this Venturi system in. Little countdown timer. I've got it set for 30 minutes on, 20 seconds off. The reason it runs my pump, the reason is if shad gets stuck on the inlet, I want it to be able to release them. And with the water doing circles, they'll release pretty quick off the pump. It wasn't very much money. It's like $13. So I thought, what the heck? You can do all kinds of timing, but I got it on a countdown timer and it just cycles all day long. 30 minutes on, 20 seconds off. There's this Blackmagic pull vac. You hook your water hose up to it right here and it creates a Venturi effect. And I want to use that to clean the bottom of this tank every now and then. It gets a lot of little scales from the shad. We'll see if it'll work. I think it will, though. It had pretty good reviews. It's about $25. I ran the water through this. I put the chlorine remover in, pretty good portion of it. I've got about 6 handfuls of salt. I'm going to put that in my filter system here and let that feed into my tank, and that'll pretty much complete the project. Hope I don't kill all my fish. All right, the shad tank is complete. I tweaked a few things around. I've got shad in it. I'm going to walk through this and show you exactly what I got going on here. The final build for now. We'll see how long this stays like this. But here we go. 500 gallon stock tank. On this end, right here, I got a water hose attachment and a valve. Part of my thinking too is if these nozzles get clogged, these little holes are pretty small, I could turn this valve and clean it out better. All I got to do is remove the coupling and I got a straight shot through my pipe. I put this one in here, this valve, so I can adjust the flow I've got the Danco filter down here doing its job, making bubbles. I had to turn it down a little bit to keep my volume up for my filter. I've got a pretty little light down there just for looks. Each one of these pipes is set up on a coupler so I can remove them. We come down through here, we've got another light, and I can change the colors on those. Go down through here, I have got a hose attachment. And the reason is, if that other side, I'd have to shut that other side off and get the pressure. This way I can fill my tank up in my boat, and that will still be running through those nozzles. Anyway, and I can shut this off right here. Here's another ball valve. We come up through here. We got 100-foot of PEX line, 3/4 inch, all coiled up in the freezer. It comes out, and then it runs through the filtering system. You already seen how I built that. I got some salt in there now. Gravity feeds out, gets this high, comes out, goes down through here. This is a slip fit. I can just lift this filter off, undo the coupling, lift it right off for cleaning. Runs through a 200 micron filter. It's an aquarium sock filter. I've got a UV light inside there. I don't know if it does a whole lot. I've got a pool heater down there, that yellow thing. So, back to the controls of the system. This controls my pump speed. I got it on full blast. I probably wish I had bought a bigger pump, because I had to adjust things down, and I still might buy a bigger pump or put two on there. We'll see how this works. So this is just your pump speed. This is your lights. I can change the lights. We can go green, orange, blue, whatever. It's pretty cool, actually. So this right here is the digital on and off switch, the thermometer. I forget what it's called, but we've already talked about this. Basically, this is for the heating element. This is for the freezer. When the temperature gets to, I think, 47 degrees, the heater kicks on. It turns on and throws the power to this. When it gets to like 50, the deep freeze will kick on. It'll throw the power to this. So moving on, this is just the UV light on and off. And then we got the pump set up on the digital timer. And that's pretty much it. These are the little lights. That's all they are. And hopefully it'll cool in the summertime. This here is just telling me the inside temperature of the freezer. So it's kind of nice to know when this freezer's running what we're getting down to. That's it. We got fish in here already. We got shad swimming around. I put a couple crappie in there, and looky here. Caught a big old carp. I don't know. I think it looks cool. My kids like it. But the fish, you know, they're all swimming with the, you know, the current. This thing is turning. I don't know how fast. I can figure it out, I guess. The water's a bubbling. They've been in here for a couple days. I've lost a few of the smaller ones. But nothing, no major incidents. You can see a little bit of the debris on the bottom. Probably doesn't hurt nothing. Big old Oklahoma crappie. Let's turn it off. Let's see what it looks like at night. They look all happy. That's a carp doing. Can't really see it. It's awful dark. But yeah. Change the color here. Maybe it'll. Anyway, I like that color the best. They think they're in the ocean, especially with a little salt water going to them now. Danco filter, or the Venturi, it's putting out bubbles, it's sucking air in, and they seem to like that. Yeah, buddy. Thank you for doing this build with me. If you would, like and subscribe to my channel. I try to do something every now and then, some fishing trip or whatever, duck hunting. Try to make it interesting. So, get any questions, leave them down in the comment section. I'll try to answer them the best I can. We'll know more as time goes on how well this thing's gonna work and what I like and what I don't like. So, once again, thank you for watching Starkey Outdoors.